Hello and welcome. I'm Peggy. Thank you for letting us share a part of your day. And today is special. I have someone here that the information he gives can help people in many circumstances and can change lives. And I'm honored to have Steve Simpson here with me. Now, Steve is an author. He's written many books. He's been on major television programs throughout the country. And we're delighted to have you, sir, in our southern part of the United States.
Delighted to be here.
And you're going to talk about, you're a child advocate.
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, basically, and I'll mention my background in a second, basically the advocate for young people. A lot of young people who are being abused or have problems or were suicidal don't know there's alternatives, don't know there's help out for them. So I've been advocating for years, whether it's on shows like this or speaking in schools or my writing, to advocate for them and give them a voice too. A lot of them are misunderstood, as you'll hear from my own story.
Yeah, you had a rather troubled childhood.
Yes, well,
and out of that, you have brought circumstance with your books to help others.
Exactly. It kind of rationalizes what I went through. Instead of worrying, being said about my childhood, it becomes a tool now to help other young people through their
beautiful
childhood. You know, so as far as my childhood, I guess I'll start with that.
All right.
You heard of an A student? You know what it is to be an A student?
Oh, yes.
Okay, I was a Z student. Okay, I was the opposite of an A student. If the teacher said, everyone can pass this test, every head would turn and look at me. I was always interrupting the class, always starting trouble. In fact, I always say teachers would gladly give up their tenure just not to have me in their classroom. Okay, and one time my lowest grade was a negative 20. And you can say, how can you get a negative number? Well, now we're talking, you know, second, third grade.
Yeah.
Keep that in mind. And what I used to do is, you see, I was jealous of the smart kids. Because I always associated, if you were smart, you had a perfect home life. And I didn't. So I was jealous of them. So I would always try to interrupt the smart kids during their, when we were taking a test. I move their hand, I get in their way. I had those old pens. When the pens would get bad and explode, I keep them because I can flick ink on their paper. But this one young man, boy, he had the best concentration. Nothing could distract him. So I got up and I literally pushed him off his seat. And the teacher said, whatever you get, go back in your seat now and I'm taking off 20 points. I said, I'm not going to even try. And instead of a zero, she wrote negative 20. Now at that point, I laughed and said, I'd have to get hundreds just to pass. Another example, what I would do is now, what was wrong with me, I would always say. I would spend probably, Peggy, 2 hours a night trying to figure out how to cheat on my next test. I was always trying to cheat. And my friends would come by and say, Steve, why don't you just study? It would take half the time. And I would say, what's the use? Because I believed, even if I studied, I'd still fail. One example I give people is that I would cut school from about third grade on. And I got away with it because no one dreamed this third grader is actually cutting school. But where would I go? This is the best part. I didn't go to parking lots to hang out, okay? I didn't go to the mall. I went to the library in the town, the local town, and I would sit there and read books, or I'd walk up to the librarian and say, my famous thing was, can I have some paper and a pen? And they'd smile and give me, and I would sit there and write short stories, poems, proses. I know they're called proses, but that was what I was writing. Now here's the epitome of a kid with low self-esteem. I was smart enough to want to go and read books and write stories from second and third grade on, even younger, and yet I thought I was stupid. Now, why was this? And we talk about the home life. Well, my father was a very violent alcoholic, and I was abused both physically and verbally. Now, the physical, it was not fun, I'll say that to you. One of the things when you're being abused physically is it could be spontaneous. I could be talking like I'm talking to you, him, and all of a sudden he just hit me for no reason at all. And some nights you wondered, is he going to stop? Like, is he going to stop beating you? But I'm going to say that as much as I'm not downplaying the physical, but however, the verbal abuse did more damage and long-term damage. Because from the youngest age on, all I heard was all these horrible things I was called, useless, stupid, I didn't want you. In fact, he raised me to call him by his first name because I didn't want you. And that is why I never tried in school. That's why my self-esteem was so low all the time because I just believed everything he said. I mean, he's one of the first adults you meet. And that's why I always would attack teachers because they were just another adult. So I would say I would get them before they would get me. I was suicidal by the time I was 11 years old. Now, I want to stress something. I always say that I didn't want to die. I just want to live. And you might say, well, that's the same thing. It wasn't, because I was 11 years old. I didn't know what it was like being dead, but I did know what it was like being alive. And it was always pain, always hurtful, always drama. There was always something new to be said about things going on in the household. I dreaded going home. You know, the funny thing is, as much as you would think I hated school, when school was off during holidays or summer, I hated it, because as much as it was like a love-hate relationship, because at least school did keep me out of the house when I was there. So ironically, as much as I make all these cracks about school, it was almost a comfort zone for me. And I didn't think things were going to get better. And this is important to stress. I wasn't dumb. I was really a smart kid. And if I knew things were going to get better, Peggy, I would have not tried to kill myself or thought of suicide. But I honestly believe it's not getting better. And that's what many people think when they're suicidal. It's hopelessness. It's I can't take this pain, and I'm not doing another 11 years of it. That's all the rest of my life. Fortunately for me, another year or two went by, and social services did step in. I ended up in foster care for a while until my mother, God bless her, eventually got her own place, nothing to do with my father, and we moved in again then. But prior to that, I was in foster care. I was in two different foster homes, and nothing but great things to say about them, by the way. Wonderful families, and I got to see how a functional family operates. Now, simultaneously, I joined a self-help group, kind of like I run now for young people. And one of the nights I come in there and I had to write something for the meeting. They asked me to write something. And the girls there were like, oh my God, this is fantastic. They said, I can't write like this. They say, how come you do bad in school? I, well, I'm stupid. But why do you say you're stupid? Well, my father said so, but he's drunk all the time. Now, another thing that blew my mind out was when I first joined this group, there was a young girl there and she was the smartest kid in the school. And that's when I was acting up in school. So we were polar opposites of each other. We were enemies. I used to bow down to her in the hallway. Here she is, you know, and here she's in this meeting for abused kids. And I said, what are you doing here? And she said, well, hello to you, Steve. How are you doing? She said, you'll find out. She tried suicide more times than I ever thought about it, but kept it all a secret. Both the parents were abusive. But this is the thing that got me. All these smart kids in the group, their parents called them the same thing as my dad called me. And there was no difference. And I came to the conclusion that it was nothing to do with me, it was him. Because here the smart kids were being called the same names as I was being called. And because, you know, you always take it on yourself as a victim of child abuse, you think I caused it. It's something that I did. Now, you might do something that perhaps any parent would be upset with. You got thrown out of school, you got in a fight in school, you failed all your tests. But there's and any parent would be upset with it. But if they abuse you, it's got nothing to do with you. An adult abuses a child because there's a sickness in them. And that's why, and usually it's alcohol or drug abuse.
But the child many times thinks it's their fault.
I blame myself. I was the worst person. Yeah. I blame myself. I always had total guilt. I thought inflation was my fault. Everything was my fault because he always told me. Even he was so drunk that he couldn't walk, he would just point at me. And I knew what he was saying. Your fault, your fault. Well, once I got the help, I learned how to study. They taught me how to study. And I switched schools. They didn't know me in this new school. And what happens? Well, all of a sudden, I start passing everything. Then I go from passing to doing better. And I made a game out of it. 5 points higher. I just want to get 5 more points. Then another 5 points higher. I actually made a game to do better and better, almost like gambling. Well, before you know it, I'm on the honor roll. Before you know it, I'm the National Junior Honor Society. I joined track just to keep myself busy. I get the MVP for the track team that year. Wrestling, pick up medals and that. Here's the best part, Peggy. They make me student of the month. They hang my picture up as a model student for a month in the hallway. Be like him. Now, Peggy, 2 years before that, that would have been a dartboard in the teacher's faculty room, okay? What was different? I could have done this any time of my life. And these smart kids that I used to pick on, I was one of them. I just didn't know it. So what I always stress, and that was what I write about also, is that how many young people today, and they turn into adults, and even as adults, think so little of themselves, and they blame themselves for certain characteristics, and it's not them. I learned that many of my habits I had were just synonymous for a child of an alcoholic. That's what you do when your parent is an alcoholic. But it wasn't Steve. It was little. So once I discovered that, I was able to get better. Now, I didn't finish school. That was a drastic mistake. But I had the self-esteem to be successful in business, to go from writing short stories as a little boy to writing full novels. And one of the things I wrote, as we discussed recently, is the Teenage and Young Adult Survival Handbook. Now, that's an insert in all my books.
This is what I have here.
Yes.
Your book, and every book you have, has this survival section.
Each novel in it. And I'll tell you why. 2 points. First is, what does the handbook have? The handbook talks about, well, like I just did. It talks about suicide. It talks about bullying. And
the
a little
teenage
different.
And young adult survival handbook. And then inside this book, this is a novel.
Right, exactly.
And then you have this table of contents, this survival.
And it discusses all the problems that a young person has growing up today, from suicide to why they should report child abuse, which I'll mention that in a minute. Self-esteem, it talks about what I just, and it doesn't matter that I just did it. It's all personal for me. So the person relates to it. They know they're not alone when they read it. And I also give them ideas how I survived, but I also try to encourage them to go back to professionals like this, to go back to the school social worker, go back to the school counselor and get help from them. Or local community centers or churches. Churches tend to have outreach programs, 12-step programs. So I encourage them not just to read my book, but once they get a little help from that, to move on from there and get better help. I even have 800 numbers in the book, a bunch of them that can help them. Two of the main ones is the National Runaway Switchboard, which is 1-800-RUNAWAY, 1-800-RUNAWAY. And because I also ran away a lot before I was in foster care. And they can find shelter for a child or even make a phone call for the child if they don't want to make it to their parents. There's also the suicide prevention line, which is 1-800-273-TALK, 1-800-273-TALK. And that's if someone is desperate enough and they have no one to talk to, they can call them. And what I stress to young people is that whether you're calling one of the hotline numbers, whether you're going to a school social worker, see, I always thought as a child, I know what they're going to say, but I was wrong. They did have more knowledge than I thought they did. And they knew more about me than I thought they did, and they were able to help me. So I stress young people that could be watching this to take that chance, take a deep breath, say a prayer for strength, call those numbers. Now, I mentioned as far as one of the things in the book, I mentioned also as bullying. Now, bullying is extremely big today, as you know.
Yes. We hear a lot about it.
And it could be also the trigger to suicide. But what young people aren't talking about is, why are certain young people more vulnerable than other ones for being bullied? Why? And no one wants to talk about that a lot. And my volunteer work over the years, I've had a youth group for over 30 years that I've run, my own personal background, friends that I've had. And what I will say is that many times, not every time, I get that, but many of the times a child is vulnerable to be bullied because they're being bullied at home. I call it the domestic bully. Mm-hmm. In my case, if your father's constantly calling you horrible names all the time, by the time you get to school, you're already worn out.
You don't think very well of yourself.
No, so no. All someone has to do is touch it. Here's a scenario that happens a lot. How many times have you had a bunch of friends together, and someone makes a tease? They tease you, Peggy, they tease me, we laugh, they tease Tara, they tease everyone there is, okay? And then the one person comes in, and they do the same exact joke to them, and they flip out and get angry. And what does the person say? You know, you always do this. I said the same thing to Steve. I said the same thing to Peggy. Why do you always get so upset? What that person may not know is that young man or young woman might be being verbally abused in their household. Mm-hmm. And by the time they get to school, it's like pulling layers of the skin off. They're so sensitive and raw that now you're saying something. You're supposed to be their friend. So a lot of people might bully someone even though they're bullying them. But I always say, that if someone is constantly in different schools, they always seem to fall into this role, check out the household, because that's an important thing. Like suicide. Now, okay. An important thing about suicide, two things on it. One is, whenever I see the news, and God forbid someone tragically commits suicide, the parents will say, we don't know why that happened. And I sit in front of the screen and say, yes, you do. Because no one wakes up one morning and says, you know, I feel like committing suicide today. That's not the way it works. It's from years of constant problems or abuse in many cases, hopelessness, and they finally have had it. So I usually say, could it be that maybe your spouse is an alcoholic? Or maybe a lot of times what also happens to a young person is you might have a girl and her father was an abusive alcoholic, the mother divorces. She gets another boyfriend, and guess what he is? Mm-hmm. He's an abusive alcoholic. She separates from him, and another boyfriend comes in, and he's an abusive alcoholic because the mom is codependent. But here's the problem with the young person. They've had every male figure in their lives saying the same horrible, demeaning things to them. So they think they're true. Now, if someone is watching this and they are thinking of suicide, what I always say to people is this. Over the years, 30 years of running a group that I have, all my writings and so on, my own personal experiences, I've known many people that were suicidal over the years, many. different walks of life, different personalities, but there is one thing they all have in common. Not half, not 90%, but 100%. They were all, those that did not commit, thought about it but didn't do it, or tried it, but thank God they didn't die. They all have one thing in common. They were glad that they never died. Why is that? Because things always get better, okay? Right. So my message to people is, no matter how dark things seem and hopeless things seem, they do get better.
All right, now we're gonna take a quick break and we'll be right back. And I have information here that I'll keep, but we have a website also that we'll have for you. So stay with us. Welcome back. And if you tuned in late today, my very special guest is Steve Simpson. And he is an advocate for young people and children. And he's written many books and he speaks all over the country and he's been in some of the big TV shows. So we're glad to have you here today. And we're talking about young people and children and how much influence the family. It all goes back to that family.
Absolutely. Now, I wanted to mention also now, during the worst of my abuse, when I was suicidal and living through it, if a teacher had come up to my classroom and said, who would like to read about suicide? Or who would like to read about child abuse? Or being a child of an alcoholic? I never would have raised my hand.
No.
No one would. So how do we get the handbook to them? This is what I've done. It's a little unique here. The Teenage and Young Adult Survival Handbook is in all my four novels. It's a book within a book.
So these are books written for young people.
Young adult
they're
fiction, young,
they're
science
stories,
fiction,
they're
absolutely.
Novels for young people. And inside is included the information.
Exactly.
Life-saving information.
Exactly. This way a young person isn't embarrassed because they could be just wanting the fiction story.
Yeah.
Or in reverse, if a concerned adult wants to get them the information, it's non-confrontational. You can say, well, I thought you liked science fiction. I thought you liked action drama because there's still a story. The handbook's with it and you pray that they read the handbook. And professionals love the idea because it takes away that struggle. How do I get that information to them without having a problem? Now, as far as the four novels, just real fast, you have Runaway. And Runaway is of two runaways, and much like myself, children of alcoholics, and they had it all mapped out, these two boys, and went to Manhattan, except it doesn't work out the way they thought it worked out. They run into what's called a street army, and a lot of problems happening, and one of them is suddenly on his own, and he was the inferior one of the two of them, didn't know what he was going to do. He gets adopted by a Robin Hood type of street army, and the toughest member is a girl, and they fall in love with each other, except that eventually train him how to protect himself and handle himself, and he goes on a revenge quest on his own. He becomes almost like a James Bond of the street gangs or a Batman, but there's a lot of revenge and there's a lot of hidden stuff. You find out the girl has her own agendas that were hidden. The next book is Child's Island. All runaways go on a trip by someone who recruits them and says, I have another place that's far from everywhere else, different dimension, and you can you'd be away from all these problems, except unfortunately the journey doesn't go where they thought it would go, and they lose their guide, and they're on their own defending this new world. Next is The World is Wrong, and The World is Wrong, you have young people that suddenly facts aren't the way they're supposed to be, things are all inaccurate, lives have changed, and they suddenly discover that a project they worked on as teenagers, to build a machine to change the world, might have worked after all, but not the way they wanted to. Once they try to fix it, it becomes a thriller and it's the world against them. Mm-hmm. And finally, there's Who Am I? Now, Who Am I combines the fiction and nonfiction. Who Am I is a young girl that's a victim of horrible domestic abuse. She ends up in foster care. And she's graduating high school. She's a star of a track team and good thing because suddenly she's being chased by hitmen. Her boyfriend, who goes to help her, suddenly has all these powers and abilities. And at first, that's a big thing for her, just in time, except because he uses his powers, he has other individuals after him. It becomes a great chase. And during all the science fiction and the excitement, they talk about their problems that young people have too. See, all my characters, no matter how fantastic the fiction stories, my stories read like a movie they'd want to see, like an exciting film.
Okay.
But all the characters are realistic. They relate to them. They could be children of alcoholics or victims of child abuse.
So these books are really an outreach to young people who are struggling.
They're entertaining and yet life-saving information inside them.
and the information, and said there is information where they can reach out for help.
Absolutely. I have a whole
section. In each book.
There's a whole section of 800 numbers of all the different organizations that they can call for free and or go on the websites and get help.
That's wonderful. And these books are available. How can people get these books?
Well, of course, on Amazon. But also, the easy way is probably go to our website, which is powerpublishingcorp.com.
Powerpublishingcorp.com.
Yeah, Corp. Powerpublishingcorp.com, exactly.
And that will give them the information to get the books or a little bit about you as
both.
Well.
Yeah, about myself. They can read about each book individually. They're soft cover. I made them inexpensive so anyone can obtain them.
And each book has the information where they can, the numbers, where they can get help.
Absolutely. There's a whole section on that. All different organizations. Different teens have different issues. So yeah. I meant specific for them and have information for them.
Do
also.
You find, and you go around the country and you speak to groups and churches and all kinds, do you find that many young people are struggling today?
Yeah, there are a lot of issues out there. You know, one out of every five children is a child of an alcoholic or drug abuser today. One out of every five children.
Oh, that's frightening.
So you can imagine, that's just one problem. Suicide is the number one cause of death of teenagers and young adults. Number one cause, it's not drunk driving, it's not leukemia, it's suicide. And I say that's an unnecessary death, it's a preventable death. So there's so many problems that are laid on them today. There are wonderful families. There are many good families, but there are many dysfunctional, broken homes, and the kids literally have no one to lean on. There's no one that they can, you know, go to for help, and that's what happens. And they take on all the guilt in the house, like I did. They're facing a lot. They really are, and the economic issues today. Parents, even in functional homes, have gotten a bad habit lately. They discuss their economic problems with their children. And you're not really supposed to do that. You can discuss it with your peer. There's nothing wrong in telling your child, we have to tighten up a little bit, you know, because things are tight. That's part of life. But when the parent says to their child, I hope we don't lose our house like the neighbor did. If I lose my overtime, we're going to be in the street. Do you realize what you just did to that 12-year-old or 15-year-old? Mm-hmm. Their grades go plummeting down. They get hopeless themselves. And even in functional homes, they're doing that. I always stress to parents, they're not your peers. Don't lean on them with your problems. Let them focus on their schoolwork. You're the adult. You focus on the economic problems and so on. So that's a big stigma that's happened lately. A lot of kids are carrying their parents' financial burdens on their shoulders, and which is unfair. They're teenagers. They're not supposed to deal with that.
That's amazing. So you found when you go around and you speak, you get the feedback from...
Absolutely. Another thing I want to point out, very important too, victims of child abuse. There's two reasons they don't. One I mentioned before, they blame themselves. I thought it was my fault.
They don't report it, for one thing.
No, but there's another reason they don't report the child abuse. Usually in most homes, there's the abuser parent, and then there's the codependent parent, who doesn't abuse but allows it to go on. The young people are afraid to get the codependent parent in trouble. So they almost don't report their abuse to protect the codependent parent. Now, what I stress to anyone who's watching this is you won't get them in trouble. You'll get them help. They'll force them into counseling, and they'll stop having relationships of abusing people. So, again, that's another reason people don't realize that the abused child sometimes is protecting the not abusing parent because they think they're all going to go to jail, and that's not going to be the case. So I stress again that, and of course, it's never your fault to be abused ever.
And in each one of these books, the numbers are there for a teenager or a young person to call for help.
Absolutely. The ones that I mentioned, the National
Suicide Board. And they're free calls.
All free calls, all free websites. It's almost after the handbook, there's like a glossary of different organizations.
Okay.
And not just America, I have for the UK and Canada also, just in case. Numbers that they can even call from there. If they're there and they need help. So, yeah, I made sure of that. And just they entertain in one sense, but in the other sense, they have life-saving information inside them.
So you have used your own childhood to bring help to hundreds and hundreds of other people.
Oh, when I speak in schools or I write my books, there's pieces of me in them because I'm reflecting my own childhood, just like you said. And they like that because I didn't learn it in a school. I lived through it. When I give suggestions in the handbook, whatever the topic is, I even have surviving the holidays in a dysfunctional home. okay? It's all my own experiences. So if a young person reads it, they relate right away because they know this person lived through this, but this person survived this, and that's the key. So it gives them hope. Well, if he survived it, then I can survive it. If he turned his grades around, I can turn my grades around. If he doesn't think of suicide anymore, maybe my life will get better and I won't think of it anymore. Everything is personally written.
That's beautiful. And these books are available, powerpublishingcorp.com. And I'll keep that information here if you didn't get it. But if you are a person concerned with young people, perhaps you're a teacher, a Sunday school teacher, someone who cares about kids, these books are available and there's help for everybody. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.
Come back. Okay?
I will. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing with us, Steve Simpson. And wherever you are, stay happy. We'll see you next time.